Okay, welcome everyone to Hope Church this morning. We're going to be continuing the series looking at God's love story. And it's a love story that is unlike any that we know or any that we experience as human beings. And really continuing in that theme, we're going to be having the second of our Bible studies in Hosea after Bring Your Own Lunch together, which is very much the same theme of God's love story. So that's going to be after lunch together today. And then on Wednesday, we have our prayer meeting at 7:30 here in the chapel. Next Sunday, a reminder that the clocks go back, but you don't have to remember, that's fine, especially those people that aren't here. If you don't remember, you'll be here not only on time, you'll even be here to help set everything up before the service, which will be lovely to have some extra help. And also next Sunday, we have members meeting, and just a reminder that this time we're not going to be providing sort of extra food. There'll be some sort of soup and stuff you can make, but it's basically a bring your own lunch again for that. We've got too many of us now to start sorting out a lunch as well. Brilliant, thank you. And yeah, and then we do have a provided lunch on the 12th of November in 3 weeks' time, I guess, and the sign-ups for that on the board at the back. Okay, well, the prophet Ezekiel was once presented with a valley full of dry bones, and this is what he was told. Then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, 'Dry bones, hear the word of the Lord.' This is what the sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you, and you will come to life." God works through his word to bring those bones to life. And he does exactly the same thing here today. Through God's word, God brings life to the spiritually dead. And that's what we pray for this morning. And we're going to sing about that in our first song together. Behold the power of his word, a power seen, yes, in creation, as creation is brought to be, but also, in, as we sing in verse 2, his voice has called us from the grave. There's only one person's voice that can do that, and that is the voice of Jesus Christ. So let's stand and sing this song together.
Trust his promise.
Please be seated. Let's come to God in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the certainty, for the hope that we have in your word, in your promise. We are in a world, Lord, of where there's really only, the only certainty is uncertainty and trouble. And Lord, we are grieved, we are horrified at what we see in the world around us. But we recognize if we take your word seriously, we shouldn't actually be surprised at that. Because what we see in the world outside is also the same world that is in our own hearts. You tell us in your word that wars and quarrels come from desires that battle within us. It's in our own hearts. And you tell us, who can say, I have kept my heart pure, I am clean and without sin? Lord, we are people who are guilty before you. This isn't how you made us. This isn't how you made the world. This is our choice. And we recognize that in this sinful state of ours, we run from you. We're dead to you. We refuse to come to you, the very God who gives life. We are like those dry bones that Ezekiel prophesied to. And yet, we've just sung there is hope. We've just sung that your word is living. We've sung that you called us from the grave. We thank you that in the gospel of your Son, you give life to the dead. This gospel meets our need. Jesus is more powerful than our unbelief. We thank you that there is hope for dead bones. There is hope for guilty sinners. And we thank you that that hope is found in the cross. And it's so astonishing, isn't it, that the place of violence, a place of bloodshed, is the very place at which reconciliation is achieved. We thank you that it is a complete reversal of what we see of the sin in our world. We thank you how your cross reverses that and brings about reconciliation and hope. And Lord, we ask that today you would raise the dead through your word. You would bring that forgiveness and life. And we pray that every one of us would be filled afresh with a wonder at this gospel of Jesus Christ, a wonder at just what an amazing Savior he is, and how this is all of your grace, all of your heart of love to those who deserve none of it. Convince us of that today, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Right, I wonder, any idea what that is? Looks a bit gross, doesn't it? Any ideas what that might be? Yeah. Say that again. Brain cells. Oh, right. Okay. Yeah. That's an interesting one. Well, you're on the right lines because brain cells are small. So we're looking at something that's small. It's probably not quite as small as a brain cell, but it's not actually something living, even though it looks a bit like a sort of worm there. Well, let me give you, I can give you, well, this doesn't help you much, does it? This tells you a bit about how magnified it is. That worm thing is about a tenth of a millimeter. It's Velcro. Okay, so you'll know what Velcro is, don't you? If you want to try, you can. Yes, it sort of sticks on, doesn't it? You can pull it apart. And you want to have a go? You've all done that, I'm sure. I mean, this is a wonderful invention, wasn't it, with kids' shoes. Do you want to have a go here? So you put that side on too. sticks together, and it's pretty sort of firm, isn't it? But yeah, kids' shoes, you didn't have to worry about shoelaces and things. You just stick this on. It's handy for adults too. Actually invented by a Swiss engineer. I'm proud of my Swiss heritage, and partly through walking his dog, and his dog got covered in these seed things that had these sort of hooks over them, in effect. And he thought, why don't we make something like this? And this is how he created this Velcro stuff that we use all the time. Why am I showing you that? Well, it helps us to understand temptation. When we are tempted to do what is wrong, temptation is something that is outside of us. Maybe it's something that we see, or maybe our friends are saying, oh, let's do this, and they want you to join in. So we're sort of surrounded by all sorts of things that might tempt us. And in one sense, you can't do anything about that. We're surrounded by that. The problem is when those temptations meet wrong desires within ourselves. So the temptations are a bit like one piece of the Velcro that's flying around, and on its own, that, in a sense, isn't going to harm you. But when it meets what's in our hearts, it sticks. And that is when we give way to sin. So maybe we're thinking, well, I want to have something that toy or that other things that some other child has. And you then, because that's what that you want, that's your desire, you maybe then steal. Or you think, well, I want to avoid getting into trouble, so you lie. Those temptations that are outside us stick on those desires in our hearts. And this is exactly what James tells us. When tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me, for God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when by his own evil desire he is dragged away and enticed. Do you see what's going on there? You've got those outside temptations. When they meet our evil desire, that is the problem. So whenever you're using Velcro to do something up, just think about how temptation works. And when you think about it, that's a bit of a problem, isn't it? Because we're full of all sorts of wrong desires. So what on earth is the answer? Well, we need to be changed on the inside so that our desires change, what we want changes, so that we come to want what God wants. And the amazing thing is, when we trust in Jesus to have our sins forgiven, he sends his Holy Spirit in us, who does change us. And it's a lifelong process. It doesn't all just happen instantly. It's a lifelong process, but God changes our hearts. He changes our desires. And one day, we will be free of all those wrong desires when we are with him in glory. But the only person that can change that is God. We can't do that ourselves. And that is the amazing thing that we find in the gospel of Jesus. And we're going to sing a song that we often sing this, but this just brilliantly summarizes, if you're wondering what's going on in the sermon later, just think back to this song, because basically this song summarizes the sermon. In the second verse here, it talks about sin being too strong. This isn't something we can conquer ourselves. Pretty much everyone around us will say, oh yeah, this is something we can sort out ourselves. God says, no, you can't. We need a savior. And this is what is such good news. This is exactly the savior that we have. So let's stand and sing this song together. No one is good. No one is holy before God. sit down. Well, we're going to read this morning, we're going to read all of John 3, but we're going to do it in two parts. So you'll find this on page 749. John 3 and verse 1. Now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, "Rabbi, we know you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the miraculous signs you are doing if God were not with him." In reply, Jesus declared, "I tell you the truth, no one can see the kingdom of God unless he is born again." "How can a man be born when he is old?" Nicodemus asked. "Surely he cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb to be born." Jesus answered, "I tell you the truth, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying, 'You must be born again.' The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit." "How can this be?" Nicodemus asked. "You are Israel's teacher," said Jesus, "and do you not understand these things? I tell you the truth. We speak of what we know and we testify to what we have seen. But still you people do not accept our testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak of heavenly things? No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the desert, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life." Well, we're going to pick up that reading again in a moment, but first I'm going to ask Julian to come up and tell us about the event in a week on Tuesday.
So we have our family fun night coming up in just over a week's time. Encourage all of you to get involved in games and activities with each other. If you have anything that you need to declutter out of your home, please bring it along to our swap shop. Clothes, books, games, all in good condition. There was one member had a rail last year of clothing, so we could have everyone bring that. Just imagine how much money we could save in the new year with shopping. Don't be pressured to pick anything up in the swap shop, unless of course your items haven't been picked up by the end of the night, then please do take it home with you. And other than that, if you are able to bring food or any refreshments, please do bring those along for everyone that evening. Thank you.
Thank you. And now Alistair's going to come and pray for us. We don't take up an offering in the service, but we have an offering box at the back. You can also give electronically. If you want to know how to do that, please talk to Mike. But as we give our gifts, we want to do so in thankfulness to God for his provision for us. So, Alistair, please lead us in prayer.
Dear Lord, we do thank you for bringing us here this morning. We didn't have to remember to breathe. We just woke up. One of your gift of life, Lord. And we do thank you, Lord, that we're here today in a comfortable building, and we have a pastor who has got an open Bible and is able to teach us. And we do thank you, Lord, for all those provisions. And those are necessarily paid by what the church gives, as you're aware, I'm sure. But the church gives us gifts as well, Lord, personal gifts of our bodies and our things we can do. And we do pray, Lord, that you can help us use all these gifts, both financial and personal, to your glory for the work here at Hope Church. Amen.
Well, let's come back now to John chapter 3, and as we pick this up, we're now moving into, I think, John's comment on what Jesus is saying, just as he later on comments on what John the Baptist has been saying. So from John 3 and verse 16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but men loved darkness instead of light, because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that his deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be seen plainly that what he has been done through God. After this, Jesus and his disciples went out into the Judean countryside, where he spent some time with them and baptized. Now, John was also baptizing at Aenon near Salim because there was plenty of water and people were constantly coming to be baptized. This was before John was put in prison. An argument developed between some of John's disciples and a certain Jew over the matter of ceremonial washing. They came to John and said to him, Rabbi, that man who was with you on the other side of the Jordan, the one you testified about, well, he is baptizing and everyone is going to him. To this, John replied, A man can receive only what is given him from heaven. You yourselves can testify that I said, I am not the Christ, but I am sent ahead of him. The bride belongs to the bridegroom. The friend who attends the bridegroom waits and listens for him, and his voice and is full of joy when he hears the bridegroom's voice. That joy is mine, and it is now complete. He must become greater. I must become less. The one who comes from above is above all, and the one who is from the earth belongs to the earth and speaks as one from the earth. The one who comes from heaven is above all. He testifies to what he has seen and heard, but no one accepts his testimony. The man who has accepted it has certified that God is truthful. For the one whom God has sent speaks the words of God, for God gives the Spirit without limit. The Father loves the Son and has placed everything in his hands. Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life, but whoever rejects the Son will not see life. For God's wrath remains on him. Well, we're going to sing once more now. A hymn that beautifully expresses the right response to seeing the reality and depth of our sin. And during this will be time for the younger ones to go to junior church. Depth of mercy, can there be mercy still reserved for me? Let's stand and sing. said this: evil is not born with us, and we are conceived without fault. And the only thing in people at their birth is what God has formed. It sounds like someone religious, someone educated. It sounds a bit sort of wordy, doesn't it? Maybe some sort of bishop or something. It also sounds reassuring, affirming, tolerant, uncontroversial, inoffensive. In fact, it sounds rather British. It's affirming fundamental human decency. Well, it was someone British. It was a British monk writing near the end of the 4th century, a guy called Pelagius, and a guy with very good motives. He was very concerned for right behavior. But in a rather un-British move, his teaching was condemned as heresy at the Council of Ephesus in 431 AD. I wonder if you knew that. And why am I saying this? Because we need to know that, because that teaching is incredibly contemporary. Here's something that someone said at the General Synod of the Church of England in 2017. The Bible teaches us that we are each fearfully and wonderfully made, and that we should praise God's gift of our creation. Thus, our diversity as human beings is a reflection of God's creativity and something to celebrate. The biblical concern is not with what we are, but how we choose to live our lives, meaning that different sexual orientations and gender identities are not inherently sinful. That speaker puts in religious language what is really the default view of our secular culture, the essential goodness of human nature. Hence, what I desire, what I feel, that's natural. That's who I am. Therefore, it is good. It is my identity. And many very well-meaning Christians, knowingly or unknowingly, have adopted the same way of speaking and thinking. Be surprised how prevalent, how easily false teaching can come in. And this morning, I want to really show why what Pelagius and his contemporary followers are saying is a lie. For one thing, it's contrary to Scripture. In that quote from the speaker at the General Synod, they quoted a psalm of David, but they rather ignored something else that David said. Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. See how Scripture can be twisted. Just because someone's quoting Scripture doesn't mean to say they're speaking the truth. We so easily fall for it. We need discernment. It's not only contrary to Scripture, it's contrary to reality. Well, that's what you'd expect, because Scripture fits reality. This isn't some sort of parallel world. No, what we have in Scripture actually fits reality. And it's thirdly contrary to the gospel. If God is essentially affirming us as we are, there's nothing to be saved from. And in fact, God's love story is no longer a love story. It's a self-help story. And that isn't good news. Now, last time we looked at the whole message of the Bible, really, as a love story. That God is portrayed as the bridegroom, just as Jesus is described as the bridegroom in that reading that we had. And this week, I really want to focus on why that is so shocking. Why it's a love story with really no human parallels. Because in this love story, the bride is repulsive and also reluctant. And that's another sort of Britishism, okay? That's a British understatement. When I say reluctant, it's more than that. She doesn't want her true husband. In fact, she hates him. And what we are saying this morning, there's nothing that could be more counter-cultural. You see, our culture says that our desires are a source of our identity, a source of pride in both senses. God is saying our desires are the problem. They don't reflect our true identity and what we are made for. So I'm afraid this will be uncomfortable this morning. As a doctor might say, this is going to hurt. You might even find this rather offensive. But I can assure you this is totally non-discriminatory. Because I can assure you, without caveat, the problem that I am exposing this morning applies equally to every single one of us here, without exception. There's not many things that you can say categorically like that, but I can on this teaching this morning. No one is being singled out, because this is a universal problem. So how are we going to come to understand that? Well, what's the way into this? Well, the way into any Christian theology is Jesus. So we're going to look at what is going on here in John chapter 3, and we discover here that the problem is my desires are wrong, not just my deeds. I'm taking it for granted this morning that we would all accept that we have done things that are wrong. If you disagree with me, then just have a chat with someone who's lived with you for a while, okay? So I'm just taking that as read. I'm focusing on desires. In other words, what you want, something deeper, because we don't always act on our desires, do we? And this is what is brought out here in our reading in John 3, verse 19. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but men loved darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that his deeds will be exposed. Yes, their deeds are evil, but there's a deeper problem. Do you see what it is? They love darkness. But love's good, isn't it? No, it's not. Love is not good if it's for something that is wrong. To love darkness is very bad. That is evil. And you sort of think, well, is John here being a bit over the top? This is a bit strong. Maybe he's just talking about particularly bad people. He's talking about terrorists or something. But we can't say that, because the context here is the world. It's all people. And even more scarily, the context is really about what you do with Jesus. It's not about whoever's committed the most heinous crimes. It's about, what do you do with Jesus in the context of a conversation with an intelligent, decent, religious man, Nicodemus? Verse 18, whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already. It's about what you do with Jesus, the one who is the light of the world. So what this is telling us, whatever you might think of the state of your life, if you are not trusting in Jesus, if you are not giving him the rights to your life, you are actually someone who hates God. You see, this light that's come into the world, who is that? It is Jesus. Jesus is light because he is God. He is good. And so you would think, well, when God comes into the world that he made, it's his world, he's going to be welcomed, isn't he? You know, if we're good, God is good, everything's happy, we're going to welcome him. What actually happens? Well, we're told in John 1, he was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. And that, again, is a bit of an understatement. Even the people who had been told that he was coming and how they would recognize him in Old Testament scripture rejected him. He was coming as the bridegroom, as someone good, and yet he was rejected. When you read about Jesus' ministry, you discover that the one thing that astonishes Jesus is people's unbelief, that he's there and people do not believe. And it's not even just disinterest, it is active hostility. In the end, Jesus is crucified. He had to be got rid of. They didn't want God close. And I wonder, how do you respond when someone asks you whether you trust in Jesus? what you think of him. What do you do? Do you change the subject? Do you try and move on to something else? Do you say, well, I don't mind sort of hearing about him, but I'm not going to get anywhere where I don't want to, I don't want him near me anywhere sort of personally. You know, Jesus is okay out there, but nowhere near my life. Jesus here talks of avoiding the light for fear their deeds would be exposed. I think there's something deeper going on here than simply just being ashamed. You know, there's some things you've done you're a bit ashamed of. I think there's something deeper than that. You're trying to avoid the blinding light of God's presence. In other words, the reality that he is God and that you are not. That he made you, that you belong to him, that he sets the rules, not you. It goes back to Adam's sin, our ancestor. Adam became suspicious of God, thought God was withholding something. And so he wanted to become God himself. He wanted to be the one to decide good and evil. He could decide what was right for him. He didn't want God to challenge his autonomy. I'll do it my way, is basically what Adam and Eve were saying. And his sin is our sin. This is something universal to humanity. We all are born with that same basic attitude. As Paul puts it, there is no one who seeks God. It means we hate the truth. Light here is a way of talking about truth, isn't it? We sometimes talk about, you know, shining a light on something or shed light on something, and it means, you know, we're finding something out, knowledge, truth. And yet we read here that no one accepts his testimony in verse 32. So Jesus is speaking the truth, but no one accepts his testimony. And this is a sort of strange combination. On the one hand, it's a blindness to the truth. Almost you just can't perceive it. But it's combined actually with a knowledge of the truth. Actually, you know the truth, but you deliberately reject it. In other words, your mind is affected by sin. There's a problem with your mind. And it's not an intellectual problem. It's a moral problem. It's not about intelligence or education. Nicodemus was very educated. He was very clever. He could even see the evidence that Jesus was someone rather special. You know, he could say, we can see you've done these signs. You know, you must have come from God. And yet, he was also clueless. Jesus says, you're Israel's teacher and you don't understand these things. He could sort of get things at one level and yet be totally clueless. Why don't you believe, Jesus says. And our problem is a bit like that of an alcoholic going to a doctor. You see, the doctor could talk about the damage being done to their body, could talk about all sorts of health impacts that this alcohol is doing. They could even get a sort of jar off the shelf with some poor person who had died, an alcoholic who had died, and their liver in a jar, and you sort of see its deformed state, and say, you know, that's what your liver will become. But the person can go home and pour another drink. Why? There's nothing wrong with what the doctor has said. The doctor hasn't said anything that's not true. There's nothing wrong with the evidence. The truth is clear. The problem is the alcoholic doesn't want to hear it, doesn't want to believe it. Do you see the problem? You can speak the truth as much as you like, but if you don't want to hear it, it won't do you any good. And it's the same with us in Jesus. Jesus talks about people that had the scriptures even, God's word, this is the truth, yet you refuse to come to me to have life. They have knowledge, and yet there's a refusal. This is something willful, and it's a refusal to receive actually something that is good. Jesus isn't saying, come and eat your greens. He's saying, come to me and have life. Sin leaves us unable to hear what Jesus says. It also means we love idols. As we reject God, as we reject the truth, we replace him with alternatives. We go to false gods, that is idols, to meet our needs for what only the real God can provide. It's something we see in Israel's history, which of course is a pattern for all of human history, a pattern of idolatry, what we understood last time as spiritual adultery, what we're seeing in those Hosea studies. Israel was full of the wrong desires, desires for what God had forbidden. In other words, what God has given isn't good enough. It's another way of rejecting God. And let me just take you to something very familiar to show you an example of this. The tenth commandment. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or his manservant or maidservant, his ox or donkey or anything that belongs to your neighbor. That word covet basically means desire. And desire can be good or it can be bad, depending on what it's for. Here, the desire is wrong because it is for what does not belong to you, for what God has forbidden. So do you see what this is telling us? It's telling us that sinful desire is sin. It's not only if you act on it. You know, it's not only if you take your neighbor's house or his wife or his donkey. And of course, it's better if you stop short of that and you don't take your neighbor's house, wife, and donkey. But the desire itself is wrong. And it's no excuse to say, well, I struggle with NHA, neighbor house attraction, or NCA, neighbor car attraction. It's just the way I am. It's the way I've been born. Or NWA, neighbor wife attraction. The problem is not something outside you. That's the problem with this word attraction. It's this idea it's something outside you. No, the problem is the desire in you. And it's a desire that God, the Creator, who is good, has forbidden. That's why it is wrong. We love idols. We have these wrong desires. So there's two conclusions at this point. One, my problem is very deep. It is not simply behavior. My whole person is involved. My mind, my emotions, my motives, my desires. Fundamentally, what I want is wrong. So the problem is deep, but secondly, it's universal. We are all born with instinctive desires that are wrong. What they are will vary from person to person. Some might have an instinctive desire to be lazy or to be violent or to want to have control or various different wrong sexual desires. But all of us have wrong desires. And this is the sort of default state of humanity. Look at what God says about humanity before the flood. The Lord saw how great man's wickedness on the earth had become, and that every inclination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil all the time. That's, in a sense, the extreme. That's when God's restraints had been taken away. Most of the time, God restrains evil so that none of us are as bad as we could be. We don't always act on our wrong desires. But understand this, is our natural state. You are capable of anything. And that's a very scary thing to say, isn't it? But if we take seriously what God says, that is what he's saying. You can point the finger at anyone else you like, but you are capable of anything. The fact that we don't do that is often just different restraints upon us, and indeed God's restraining grace. But all of us are guilty of wrong desires. And fundamentally, that deepest wrong desire is that hatred towards God. If you're not trusting Jesus, that is hatred to God. I wonder how you're feeling at this point. Well, I actually want you to feel a bit worse. Let's understand why this is bad news. For one thing, it leaves us condemned. That's how John 3 ends, isn't it? Whoever rejects the Son will not see life, for God's wrath remains on him. Why? Why is this such a big deal? Well, rejecting Jesus, rejecting God, is to reject the one who is good. There is no good, there is no life outside God. So if you are rejecting God, I don't care how much you say you're for the good, you're not, because good is only found in God. To disobey God is to choose evil. Evil. Good has no existence outside of God. So if you're not for God, if you're not choosing God, you are choosing evil. You are loving darkness. And what do we say about people who choose evil? Well, they should be condemned. They should be punished. But that then applies to us on this same logic. We willingly choose wrong. Therefore, we are under this condemnation. We're dead. This is how Paul puts it in Ephesians 2. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath. I told you this would hurt. Dead here does not mean passive. Dead here refers to an active rebellion against God. You can see what's going on there. People are doing things, rejecting God, disobeying God. You are dead in the sense that you are cut off from the God who is life. There's a hostility to God. You're this reluctant bride. So dead in this sense means that you're trapped. You can't do anything to change your condition. You are stuck as you are. Or another way to put it is that you're enslaved. You're following your desires, your cravings. You're following what this world says. Peer pressure, you're not free at all. You're simply following what people say around you and what they approve of. Look how it's put in Titus. At one time, we too were foolish, disobedient, deceived, and enslaved by all kinds of passions and pleasures. We lived in malice and envy, being hated and hating one another. We're deceived as well as enslaved. And notice that we lived in malice and envy, being hated and hating one another. This leaves us alone. You see, if you reject God, if you're trying to be God yourself, you are then in competition with everyone else trying to do exactly the same thing. You can't have everyone being God, can you? Or if you do, you're going to have conflict. You're going to have comparing. There's going to be an attempt to control others to meet your desires. And of course, the more you want that control, the more you can't trust others, and the more you are left alone. It's a tragic thing. God made us not to be alone, and yet in our sin, we are living in a way that leaves us alone. And we are left with, or we are in a sinful identity. What I mean by that is that sin isn't simply what you do, it is what you are. It's the whole person. We sin because we are sinful. That's pretty offensive, isn't it? You're talking about someone's identity. You're not meant to talk about that today. You're not meant to criticize that today. But that is exactly what Jesus says. What does he talk about? He talks about a bad tree bringing forth bad fruit. What's the identity of the object? It's a tree. And the sort of fruit it brings out reflects the sort of tree that it is. It's the same with us. The fruit of our lives shows what we truly are. Whereas Jesus puts it in Mark 7, uncleanness isn't something from outside, it comes from within. We sin because we want to. We are responsible. If you like, I am the problem. We always want to put it onto someone else, but no, I'm the problem. Well, how are you feeling at this point? If you're feeling helpless, if you're feeling hopeless, if you're thinking, well, look, what I'm saying here is just a bit almost unreasonable. This is impossible. I can't change all my desires. You know, what's God expecting of me? Well, if you're feeling that, you're actually understanding. Because this message truly is that we are hopeless. We are helpless. We can't make ourselves want God. We really are in a big problem. And it's when you see that, it's when you feel that, it's when you get to almost the end of yourself in that way, and it's very humbling. It hurts. But when you get to that point, these words sound very different. Something we hear at Christmas services. You shall call his name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. That suddenly becomes very precious. That isn't just some sort of nice Christmassy phrase. The angel is saying there that there will be a savior, not a tutor, not someone to tell you how to do a better job, a savior. And a savior who actually deals with sin in all of its depth and horror. So let's finish with just exploring that more. Why actually is this good news? You see, these different doctrines we're going to be looking at in these sort of coming times when I'm preaching are in many ways what we might think of as hard doctrines. They are they're hard to get your head around. I've struggled with this week. But I want to show us each time that they are good news. There may be things we don't fully understand. There may be things that we find hard. But actually, they are good news. And far better than any alternative. And one reason why this is good news is that it explains. One person put it like this, that our sort of radical sinfulness is one part of the Bible's teaching that is empirically verifiable. In other words, you can sort of test it by what you see. We see this lived out in our lives. We see it in the world. If you like, the state of the world as we see it today is not a mystery. The world actually is not as bad as it could be. And yet, why do we keep on making the same mistakes? It doesn't make sense if you believe that people are inherently good. Surely we would have learnt by now how to make better choices. You know, we're not the first generation to think that war is not a terribly great idea. You know, people have actually thought of that before. We're not the first generation to say, oh, we need some action against poverty or whatever. People have thought that before. People have tried all sorts of things before, but we keep falling into the same pattern. We're not the first generation to think, well, wouldn't it be better if people were a bit kinder to one another? It hasn't taken sort of 21st century social media or something to teach us that. But people have been saying that for millennia, and yet we still speak as we do. That shows us that education, political change, whatever. Not that it is of no value, but it doesn't solve this basic problem. This doctrine explains. It explains the internet. See, that the internet removes a lot of the social restraints on behavior, doesn't it? It gives that sort of anonymity. So much of what we don't do is because of sort of constraints upon us or what people will think or whatever. Well, in many ways, the internet reveals our true selves, doesn't it? And what do we find on the internet? Well, it's so much of the pornography, the trolling, the vicious language. It's showing us our true selves. It explains our behavior. You know, do you ever say, "Oh, I don't know what came over me"? Well, you do now. I've just been telling you this morning what came over you. It's actually not something mysterious. It's something that's very inbuilt within you. It explains children. Children are not innocent. From the youngest age, two children and one toy is not going to end well. And that affects how we think of education. Whatever you might think of homeschooling, the one thing it doesn't do is stop children being sinners. You're going to go wrong in parenting unless you realize the biggest problem for your child is not outside influence, it's the sin in their own heart. And we can't solve that on our own. It explains. And this might sound strange, but there is an equality and a fairness in what God is teaching here. You don't actually get this anywhere else. If you go back to Pelagius, it's down to you. It's down to you to choose better. It's down to you to perfect yourself. It's self-help again. But when you think about it, that's not terribly fair, because your ability to help yourself, your ability to choose better, depends on a whole pile of things outside of your control, not least the sort of teaching you may have, the sort of example you may be being given, your upbringing. Depends on your personality too. What if you're born without a particularly nice personality? What if you're someone actually rather hot-tempered? It's not terribly fair, is it? Some people have got an advantage over others. And it's all down to you. Or take our sort of modern morality. And it is a morality. Where we're told to live according to your desires. Well, actually, no one wants that. It's profoundly inconsistent. If you have a desire for violence, you're not meant to express that. That isn't meant to be part of your identity. So actually, it's not simply just follow your desires. It's actually follow the desires that we say you think you should follow. But who decides? Well, whoever is in cultural power. It's actually all about coercion. It's not freedom. It's actually about people just exerting their cultural power to try and get other people to behave as they want. The late Tim Keller gave this illustration, sort of comparing. Imagine someone in a sort of a warrior tribe 1,000 years ago. In that culture, they are told to, well, express the violent tendencies within you. That's how you can show your sort of manliness or whatever. But suppress those homosexual desires. Those aren't the right thing. Whereas in our culture today, it's the exact opposite. You need to go to anger management, but express the other sexual desires. What's the difference? It's purely what the culture around accepts. It's arbitrary. Isn't it fairer to let our maker tell us, the one who made us, to let him tell us how he expects us to live? That is actually fair. But the other thing here is that the Bible's teaching on sin is a wonderful equalizing doctrine, a democratizing doctrine, in that we are all the same. People say they want equality. Well, this is actually one equality people don't like. We always want to say, oh no, but I'm a bit better than someone else. Well, let's really believe in equality. The equality that God teaches, and this equality says we're all in the same boat. We all have disordered, sinful desires. And it doesn't matter about your background. It doesn't matter about your parents or your education, your intelligence, how much power you have, your religiosity, your culture. It doesn't matter about any of those things. We are all the same. The Pharisee is just as sinful as the tax collector and so-called sinner, the people they despised. It's just expressed in different ways. This is a wonderfully equalizing doctrine. You might think you're respectable, but yet you are still guilty of these wrong desires. And when you realize that's the problem, when you realize that helplessness, you recognize God's answer is extraordinary good news. And this is the true good news. There is an answer. It would be terrible if I was just going through all of this and then saying, well, that's just how we're stuck. And it's an answer that we don't deserve. It's an answer of grace, which fundamentally is that it's God's action to save. You don't save yourself. God saves you. You see, we won't choose God. We won't go to the Savior. So the Savior comes to us. What do we read in John 3, verse 17? God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world. Well, that's an astonishing statement, isn't it? Given everything I've said. But to save the world through him. If your jaw doesn't drop in astonishment at that, you haven't understood what's going on here. This is God's love for the world, for people who are dead in sin. And it's a love unlike anything we experience. This is the bridegroom loving a repulsive and, yes, reluctant bride. Someone more than hard to get, this bride is hostile. She is dead in the sense that she won't come to her true husband. And yet God overcomes that. He brings life. He changes his bride. Look at these passages we read before. Look how they continue. We were by nature objects of wrath, but because of his great love for us. You see how great the love is? God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive. We were dead. He's made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. Do you see how sweet this is? Or how does Titus continue? But when the kindness and love of God our Savior appeared, he saved us. Not because of the righteous things we had done, because we haven't. But because of his mercy, he saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit. In other words, this is God's work alone. We can't contribute to it. And you might be thinking, well, hang on, how does God actually do this? Well, that's what we're going to unpick in the subsequent messages. We're not going to do all of that today. But you can see here the hint of it, and it actually connects with what Jesus was saying to Nicodemus. He saves us through the washing of rebirth. This whole thing about being born again, of being given new life, that's what Jesus said to Nicodemus. This is the work of his Holy Spirit. And crucially, it happens in response to his word, in response to this message about Jesus. Why is Jesus talking to Nicodemus? He's talking to him because it is through that revelation, through that understanding, that Nicodemus can come to know this new birth. God works through his word. What do we say at the start of the service? How do those dry bones live? It's God's word that brings life. So this is the challenge. You are all hearing God's word this morning. And this message about Jesus is for the world. It is for everyone. So what are you going to do? Is God speaking to you, calling you today? His command is to believe, to trust in Jesus, the only Savior, because whoever believes in him is not condemned. That is sweet news, and it demands a response. Let's respond as well in song. Oh, how the grace of God amazes me. It loosed me from my bonds and set me free. What made it happen so? His own will, this much I know, set me as now I show, at liberty. This is a wonderful celebration of God's grace. Close in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, thank you that we can truly sing of your grace. We can sing of your work, of your mercy, of what you have done to save. And we pray, Lord, that you would rescue us from the sort of self-deception of thinking the problem isn't as bad as what you make out. Lord, help us to humble ourselves before you, to see the depth of our problem, to see our guilt before you, and to see the sweetness of these words of Christ, that he has come not to condemn, but to save, that you have this incredible heart of love to sinners. Oh Lord, may we not just brush this off. May we see that this connects with the issues we maybe are struggling with each day, the things going on in the lives around us, that fundamentally our problem is needing to know you, to have Jesus as our Savior. Oh Lord, we pray, open blind eyes, unstop deaf ears, and yes, raise dead sinners, we ask today. Work through your word, work by your Spirit, and accomplish your purpose. We ask it in Jesus' name.